Welcome to the second day of the 9th edition of the Hindu Lit for Life. The event will start shortly. I request you all to put your mobile phones on silent mode, please. We would like to remind you that coffee and tea can be bought at the stalls outside the auditorium. Also, the festival is making efforts to become a zero-waste festival. So we are discouraging people from buying plastic water bottles. There are bubble tops placed at strategic locations in the venue. So you can fill your, you can get water in your own bottle from the bubble tops. For shopping too, please get your own bags. For those active on social media, follow us on the Hindu Lit for Life page on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And if you wish to post something about the festival, please do so at hashtag LFL2019. There will be book signing after each session. The authors will be available at the book signing lounge right outside the pavilion. I would like to take a minute to thank our sponsors in association with NewsX, associate sponsor VR Mall Chennai, fresh food partner ID Foods, session sponsor United India Insurance, bookstore partner Higginbotham's, water partner Archie Water, radio partner Fever FM. Brought to you, the festival is brought to you by Theme. We start with our first session, The Art of Crafting Stories, readings from the shortlist for the Hindu Prize 2018 Fiction. Amitabha Bagchi, Anjum Hasan, Anuradha Roy, Arunava Sinha, N. Kalyan Raman, Neelum Saran Gour, and Perumal Murugan will be in conversation with Pankaja Srinivasan. Amitabha Bagchi is the author of 4 novels. His most recent work, Half the Night is Gone, has been shortlisted for the Hindu Prize 2018. Anjum Hasan's books have been nominated for various awards, including the Man Asian Literary Prize, the Hindu Prize, and the Crossword Fiction Award. Her short stories, essays, and poems are widely published. Anuradha Roy's latest novel, All the Lives We Never Lived, was published worldwide in 2018 and has won the Tata Book of the Year Award. It has also been nominated for the Hindu Prize. Anuradha's books have been translated into over 15 languages, including Russian, German, Italian, Hebrew, and French. Arunava Sinha, who translates classic and contemporary Bengali fiction and nonfiction, has won the Crossword Translation Award twice. N. Kalyan Raman's translation of contemporary Tamil poetry has been widely published in journals and anthologies, both in India and abroad. His latest work, Poonachi, The Story of a Black Goat, has been shortlisted for several awards, including the Hindu Prize. Neelum Saran Gour works as professor of English at the University of Allahabad. Her recent work includes Three Rivers and a Tree, The Story of Allahabad University, Allahabad Arya, Stories about Allahabad, and Invisible Ink. Rikyum and Raga Janaki, a fictional biography of the famous gramophone singer Janaki Bai Ilhabadi, is her latest novel. Perumal Murugan has published anthologies of poems, short stories, novels, and essays. 7 of his novels have been translated into English. They will all be in conversation with Pankaja Srinivasan, who is the senior deputy editor with The Hindu. I welcome the guests.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a special session because we are going to be in conversation with, we are going to be hearing the authors who are shortlisted for the Hindu Prize for Fiction. And yes. So it's been amazing reading all their books one after another. I just got them about a week ago, and I've never read so furiously or so fast before. But it's been a joy just going through the vast range of subjects that they have written on, and in all their different styles of writing and the different subjects they've spoken, there are some things which are startlingly similar. You know, they talk of history, there is politics, there are human foibles, there's a whole thing about women and, you know, the role of women and the lives of women. There is humor, and there's also a ghost and a goat. So you can't ask for more than that. So I'm sure you want to hear them read from their books, so I'll not take up any more of your time. What I will do is I will ask each one to read a passage from their book, and if they have the time and if they would like to, maybe say a couple of words to describe the book or what the book is about or whatever it is they want to say about their book. Is that all right? Is that all right? That works? Mr. Murugan, yes? Yes? So that is that. So we have, I have to make a special mention of Mr. Kalyan Raman and Mr. Arunava Sinha. Mr. Arunava Sinha has translated Shirshendu Mukhopadhyay's Goinar Baksho into The Aunt Who Wouldn't Die. So that's the ghost story. And Mr. Kalyan Raman has translated Mr. Perumal's Poonachi, The Black Goat. And to borrow a line from Mr. Arunava Sinha in one of his earlier articles, you know, he says there are some books that cannot be written in English, but you know, that's why there are translators, and we are really, really grateful that there are translators, because so much of rich literature in the vernacular now comes to us thanks to people like Mr. Arunava and Mr. Kalyan Raman. So on that note, we will start. Can we start with you, Anjum? Yeah, yeah. So, no, you can have a mic. Yeah, you could either come here or you could use them. Yes, yes, yes. So, Miss Anjum Hasan, please do give her a big hand.
I thought I will stand and read because I can't see you, and unless I can see my audience, it doesn't work. So this is the book that I'm going to read from. It's a collection of stories called A Day in the Life. My second book of stories. And stories are something I really enjoy doing very much, even though I am a novelist as well, and a kind of half-baked poet. But stories are really my deepest love in some ways, partly because they offer so much possibility. Not just possibility in terms of subject matter. It's not a textbook, a book of stories. It's not different chapters on a different theme. It's just different ways of approaching life, different forms even. Even though it is the short story that I'm doing every time, there's a sense of possibility with the form. So some of the pieces in this book, a couple at least, are closer to the autobiography. While being stories, a few are more essay-like, some are more traditional tales, some are verging on parables. There's one story that is like a historical throwback to 19th century Banaras. So it is a very eclectic collection. And they are also of different lengths. They have slightly different styles, all of them. So the idea is to try and keep myself as interested as I can in my own writing, to sort of extend the interest that I have in my own life, and then extend that interest to other people and to other lives. So I'm going to read from the first story. It's called The Stranger, and I won't say very much about it, except that Many of my stories are about the solitary individual, about the individual who is slightly at an angle to his world, to his society. And the context, the environment in which he or she find themselves alienated is very important to me. Is it a room in a city? Is it a small town? Is it a village? Is it, where is it? In this case, it's a hill, it's a very hilly landscape, it's a hill town. There were no new ideas to be found in the city, so I retired last year to this small town, an experiment to see if I could live in a house with a tiled roof that sometimes leaked and little storybook windows that muffled rather than let in light. 4 months straight, it rained with pounding urgency, book ended by two of drizzle. Sentences that I thought had no currency anymore, not in the 21st century, still applied here in this drenched hill town. It was a dark and stormy night, or the wind howled in the trees and rattled the window panes. One could imagine a very old place, a sparser and hardier monsoon existence hidden in the folds of the green valleys, even though they'd been killing off the vestiges in recent years, building hotels over the Christian graveyards and glassy shopping complexes where there'd been trees and empty space. Still, a few bungalows with compounds and driveways from 100 years ago remained. And in the bazaar, lots of those crooked little two-storied split-level shop houses with wooden casements, which too must have been here at least since the British were writing in their gazetteers about who was up to exactly what business in the district. With the rain and the daily power cuts, the Gothic mist creeping over everything all the time in the season, and the silence that lay over the hedgerows in the lanes away from the town center, this was still a place where you could play at being someone else. I'd seemed to be coasting along like everyone else in the city, but was really eyeing something deeper. A love affair or a glittering friendship. I was lonely and didn't see it. When this hit me, when I turned 40, then 45, and still felt unmade, unresolved, still chasing something just round the corner, I stopped. I had some money from 2 decades in the industry, if not scaling the heights of the corporate ladder, then not sliding down it either. Enough to ride on for a few years if I yielded all ambition. So that's what I decided to do. Become nobody, or at least a sincerely regular man. Cease thinking I was going to get anywhere, either in the realm of intellectual achievement or human relations. What can better aid coming down to earth than a half-forgotten small town? That stained suburban air, the permanent emanations of open sewers and busy bakeries, a whole population's worth of people with reduced hopes, happy to cut their coats according to their clots. I've been here almost a year now, one monsoon to the next, and I have a house of 3 small rooms, which is too big for me, a talkative cook in a burqa, and a target of getting through all the moldy books in the back rows of the local library, which no one seems to have touched since circa independence. I do try to give some kind of shape to my days, watching the blackbirds with my morning coffee, walking with the late afternoon sun when there is one, helping, because I was inveigled into it, the landlord's middle school going boy and girl with their homework, just sitting around in the evenings, as I drink brandy with hot water or bad wine or whiskey with ice on summer nights when it's really warm and I'm feeling like I might start to be sorry for myself. Who was it who said Proust's pinings and dissatisfaction represented the illness of the cultivated classes in a capitalist society? I'm trying, with the benevolent aid of my friendly neighborhood liquor store, to undo my cultivation. And sometimes casting off these chains can hurt. I wake up in the dark, it could be 4 a.m. or well past 7. The clacking rhythm of rain on the roof seems to be saying, I'm here to stay. Okay, I tell it, I can live with you. It's all right to wake up in the interminable darkness, not knowing what day of the week it is. I stay in bed till Amina bangs on the door. The bell stopped working. Is it Tuesday, Amina? I don't know. I just fell. I look at her left hand cradled in her right. You haven't broken it. She glares at me. There's a thick, determined moss everywhere and layers of black mold and grey lichen on the compound paving, mushrooms growing from fallen branches, grass sprouting from the gaps in the roof tiles, a whole rain-fed lushness trying to break out of the earth and swallow the town. Amina's burqa is soaked on one side and her coal-lined eyes a little teary. I ask if she wants me to take her to a doctor. I'll go home and see. I can't move it right now, but it might be better tomorrow. Go by the pharmacy at least and get some painkillers. Don't know if the shops are open, she says. They burnt the Quran last evening. Those bastards, sons of bastards. I heard about it on my way here. Again, I asked, startled, but it was different in the winter. Someone had stoned the mosque in the nearby taluk. The explanation in the bazaar was that it was all political, meaning that someone had been paid or instigated to do it. A riot was said to be brewing and protest marches were undertaken. The town shut down. Then the pressure of the incident dissipated. They burned the Quran Sharif. Someone should die for this. Thank you.
Neelum, will you read? Sorry? Yeah, you sit there. You sit there and you read. And Requiem in Raga Janaki is absolutely lovely, lovely book. And I just must quickly share where Janaki Bai Lahabadi has tea for the first time. And when she's asked, how is the taste? How would you describe the taste? So she thinks for a bit and she says, it tastes like re in Rag Purvi. So that's Neelum Gour Saran for you. Thank you.
Hello. I'll just speak three or four lines about the book and leave the passage to speak to you. My novel, Requiem in Rag Janaki, is about a forgotten woman singer of the gramophone age, Janaki Bai Allahabadi. It's about an artist negotiating between a life in real time and a life in art. And importantly for me, it's about the world of Hindustani classical music in the closing years of the 19th century and the opening years of the 20th. My narrator is a prickly old observer, 90 years old, whose voice you hear in the passage I'm going to read. You want me to talk about her after all these years? So be it. Maybe you can get a book out of all this. Me, I'm content to turn this raga into a requiem. Isn't that what Vilas Khan did? Tuned his story to a note of grieving, sang it to the corpse of his father, Tansen, and the corpse raised its hand in benediction. Some years back, you might have heard that raga on All India Radio every time the country went into state mourning for a leader. What? Another story. Patience. It shall come. Somewhere in my rambles when its time is ripe. And since it's my stories you are after, and since you are my patrons, promoters, and paymasters, I'll let loose some on you right away. But please don't think me your chattering relic. I'm no hireling of your museum, understand this. I am an artist, and we artists had our pride. Let not our shifts and rags mislead our hosts into imagining that we were subjects of lesser empires, for the sovereignty of excellence was our cause, that others could only gawp at. Yes, even the most powerful excuse my grandiloquence. This I learned from Rajab Ali Khan Sahib, a friend of my family who used to be Darbar musician at Devas. He once received rupees 2,500 from the Maharaja of Indore. Now this Rajab Ali Khan was a man of whimsies, famous for the way he dealt a severe shoe beating to a Tongawala who had cruelly whipped his horse, and then commanded the man to drive to a mithai shop, bought 2 sears of jalebis, and personally fed them to the whipped animal. A rare eccentric. The story ran in my family. One other weakness he had, apart from music, and that was itra. How many of you have experienced those Kannauj perfumes? Inhaled the ether that rises out of those cut glass vials of floral oils, those visitations of rosewater and rajnigandha, mimosa or acacia, sandalwood and camphor, musk or first rain on parched earth? By all accounts, an expensive taste for a mere musician, you would say, and I would agree. A taste for the rais, not the poor artist. But the money that warmed his Sherwani pocket, earned by an evening of music, had kindled his longing. So he hailed a tonga and told the tongawala to drive to the best itar shop in Indore on his way back to Devas. He chose the best perfume. The shopkeeper looked doubtfully at him, his humble clothes, his well-worn shoes, and sized him up. When Rajab Ali asked the price, he received the surly answer. "It is much too expensive for you, sir." Rajab Ali was stung. He well understood that fine semitone of disdain in the merchant's response. He who dealt in the tiniest shifts of inflection in the human voice. "I asked to know how much it is, sir," he repeated in a louder voice. The merchant felt the bristle of indignation and said, "It is 150 rupees a vial." "And how many vials have you in stock?" asked Rajab Ali. 10, sir," was the baffled answer. Rajab Ali took the banknotes out of his pocket and laid them before the dealer. "Then," he said, taking off his battered footwear, "be so kind, Janab, as to take this whole accursed lot in your shop and pour them into my shoes. Pray do not gasp. I have heard this saring shocker narrated many times in our courtyard, and there's more of the same for you. Can you endure another one? Then listen. There was a poverty-stricken Lucknow maestro, Haidari Khan, whose only demand of the unknown rais, who'd driven up in his carriage to his dank and lowly lane with a request for a song, was a filling meal of malai and puris, enough for him and his wife when he finished the recital. He was taken away in the carriage to an opulent mansion, and the poor fool didn't realize who his host was. Yes, none other than the heir to Nawab Saadat Ali, Ghaziuddin Haider himself. Later, when he'd become a court performer at the beck and call of the young prince, he gave his employer such a piece of his mind that it thrills my heart just to remember and repeat it. The prince had summoned him on a caprice and commanded, "Sing to me, Ustad. Make me weep today. I am in a mood for plenteous tears. Sing, and if my tears should fail to flow, be assured you shall be beheaded. Make no mistake." The terrified maestro sang and was relieved to behold his patron's eyes moisten and presently overflow. When he finished, he was asked by a mellower master, "That was stirring, Ustad. Speak. How may we reward you?" "Then, Huzur," replied Haidari Khan, I beseech your highness never to lay such conditions on me. If you did commit the folly of rashly beheading me, think what a loss it would mean to your state. A mere princeling like you, when dead, is easily replaced, but never an artist like me. I can still hear Janki's dense, throaty chortle as she removed the hookah from her mouth to laugh at this one. Thank you.
Mr. Amitabha Bagchi's work, and I'm looking with envy at that book because I got manuscript form. So I think I'm going to take that one. So from Janki Bai Ilhabadi's court, we will now move to the akhada, and I invite Mr. Bagchi to tell us a little bit about it.
Thanks, Pankaja. Thanks for the Hindu people for inviting me and shortlisting my book, the jury and all that. So my book is titled Half the Night is Gone, and so I'll tell you in a moment what it's about, and I'll read a little passage. But I have to say that this morning I heard something, just earlier in this session, I heard something which kind of a little bit landed on my head, and I realized that I've been waiting to hear this formulation for many years, and somehow implicitly I knew it, but I had not heard it said anyone say it as pithily as you know, the one and only Arunava Sinha said it, that there are some books which cannot be written in English. And I realized that since the time 20 plus years ago, I read the preface of Raja Rao's Kanthapura, in which he asked the question that how do you express in English an experience which is sort of lived in a different language, in an Indian language, is something that I've been dealing with. And I realized that precisely the formulation that Arunava has offered, and I had not unfortunately heard it before, is a kind of set of shackles that I have been struggling over the years, especially with this book, to fight off. I cannot claim success in the process of fighting off these shackles, nor will I accept failure. I just want to draw your attention to the fact that I have been trying. This book, Half the Night is Gone, there's a story within a story. There's a novelist called Vishwanath. He's a Hindi novelist, Sahitya Academy Award winner. The year is 2008. He's struck by grief because his only son has died. And Vishwanath, who's earned a tremendous acclaim as a satirist, is now suddenly thinking that he's made some mistake in his literary career. And he starts kind of writing this other book, which is set in the place where he was born and where he grew up, which was a merchant family household where his father was a servant. So he starts writing this book about Lala Moti Chand and his family who live in Old Delhi. But I'm going to read you a part of the opening, the letter which he writes. So Vishwanath typically finishes his manuscript, ties it up in white thread, sends it to the publisher, you know, four typos, nothing more than that. But this time, for the first time, he's unsure, and he sent him a few pages. And he sent him this rambling letter along with it. And I will read to you a bit from that letter, which also touches on some of the themes of this book. Perhaps it is because my son has died that I'm thinking of dead people today. I don't know if I ever told you that a few weeks after the announcement of the Padma Shri, I happened to be in Lucknow, and as I always did when he was alive, I went to meet Manohar Lal Ji. I thought he, the man who loved me like I was his own son, who had been so generous with his time when, as a young boy, I dreamed of becoming a great scholar by writing a path-breaking dissertation on his work, who consoled me when Mishraji stole my writing, consoled me in words my own father would not have known how to say, who, knowing the deep disappointment the end of my academic dreams had brought, had been doubly happy when I went to show him a copy of my first novel, holding me by the hand and sitting me down next to him, a boy sitting next to a sage, saying, "We are equals now." I thought that he would say something that would allow me to finally exult in the achievement I knew to be tainted, because it was given by the same system that has caused untold suffering to so many. When I got there, he met me as warmly as he had ever done. He congratulated me on the award, but perfunctorily. Then he turned the conversation, as he often did, to the Ramcharitmanas and to Goswami Tulsidas. He began to recount the story of how a meeting with a film director he knew in Bombay had inspired him to write his classic fictionalized biography of Tulsi. I had heard the story many times, of course, and like all those times past, I let him tell it for the pleasure of hearing him talk. But that day, his tone was different. Instead of his usual raconteur's flair, his stagey gusto, he told the story like a headmaster gently admonishing a bright pupil. He talked, as he always did, about how Tulsi's greatest achievement was bringing Ram's story to the people in their own language, about how Tulsi's idea of mounting different episodes of his Ram Leela in different parts of Banaras made the whole city a stage and made each Banarsi a subject of his beloved King Ram. Some people say that Goswamiji was the enemy of rationality, purveyor of blind faith, he said. They don't realize that despite being a scholar and a Brahmin, he prized the story of Ram from the clutches of the twice born and distributed it among the poor and the illiterate. Tell me, Vishwanath, what could be more socialist than that? He used the phrase "some people." At any other time, he would have smiled mischievously and he would have said, "Atheists like you." He said, "some people, Sarvesh." That's when I knew he was rebuking me. I felt like he had punched me in the stomach. He talked for a while, rehearsing various bon mots on how he went about writing the book and what people had said about it, all stories I had heard several times before. Finally, when I said I had to leave, he stopped. He hesitated, as if he were trying to figure out what to say. After a moment, he started talking again, as if he had not heard me say that I wanted to leave. He began telling me about some mushaira he had been to. A humorist called Dilawar Figar had read something about Ghalib, he said. And he repeated some of the funny couplets from that nazm, none of which I can remember now. Eventually, he recited this couplet, a serious one, that he said had struck him as true and beautiful. Pahunch gaya hai wo us manzile tafakkur par, jahan dimag bhi dil ki tarah dhadakta hai. He has reached that stage in his spiritual journey where the brain too beats like a heart. Then he stopped abruptly, a guilty look on his face. When I recall that moment, the veins in my head begin to throb, those angry veins whose pulsating rage, and I knew immediately this was what he was saying, had prevented my head from beating like a heart. It was the only time I left his presence without touching his feet. He wrote a couple of letters to me after that, but I didn't answer them. He died a few months later, and I never saw him again. I felt some remorse when he died, but nothing like what I feel now after relating this incident to you. When I remember that day, that expression of his, a father trying hesitantly, apprehensively to correct a grown son, my heart fills to bursting, and I feel like burying my face in his chest and weeping like a child. But that chest and the heart within it, the heart that was big enough to accommodate the entire world with all its shortcomings, not once or twice, but in each of his several books, are now both ash. And no matter how much I might want to be one, I am no longer a child. Thank you.
I'll invite Mr. Perumal Murugan to read a passage from Poonachi in Tamil. And the same passage, Mr. Kalyanaraman will read it in English. Thank you.
அன்பிற்குரிய நண்பர்களே அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். பூனாச்சி என்னும் பூனாச்சி அல்லது ஒரு வெள்ளாட்டின் கதை என்னும் இரண்டு தலைப்புகளை கொண்ட இந்த நாவலை நான் முதலிலே ஒரு நாவலாக எழுத வேண்டும் என்று திட்டமிட்டு செய்யவில்லை. ஒரு கிட்டத்தட்ட 2 ஆண்டுகள் எழுதாமல் இருந்துவிட்டு அதற்கு பின் ஒரு புனைவில் பயிற்சி விடுபட்டு போய்விட்டதா, திரும்ப எழுத முடியுமா என்ற எண்ணம் வந்தபோது எழுதி பார்க்கலாம் என்று, ஒரு சிறுகதையாக எழுதலாம் என்று ஒரு வெள்ளாட்டை பற்றி எழுதத் தொடங்கினேன். அது சில சமயம் நாம் திட்டமிடுவது நம்முடைய திட்டத்தை மீறி வேறெங்கோ கொண்டு சென்றுவிடும். அதுபோல சிறுகதையாக எழுதலாம் என்று தொடங்கிய இது என்னை அறியாமல் அது நாவல் வடிவத்திற்கு வந்து சேர்ந்தது. அதனுடைய ஆங்கில மொழிபெயர்ப்பு பூனாச்சி, இதுதான் இப்போ ஹிண்டு பிரைஸுடைய ஷார்ட்லிஸ்டில் இருக்குது. இந்த ஏன் வெள்ளாட்டை பற்றி எழுதலாம் அப்படின்னு தோணுனதுக்கான ஒரு சின்ன இதை முன்னுரையில் சொல்லியிருக்கேன். அந்த பேசேஜ் படிச்சுட்டு நாவலிருந்து ஒரு பத்தி மட்டும் நான் படிக்கிறேன். மனிதர்களை பற்றி எழுத அச்சம், தெய்வங்களை பற்றி எழுதவோ பேரச்சம். அசுரர்களை பற்றி எழுதலாம், அசுர வாழ்க்கையும் கொஞ்சம் பழக்கம்தான். சரி, விலங்குகளை பற்றி எழுதுவோம். ஆழ அறிந்தவை 5 விலங்குகள்தாம். அவற்றில் நாயும் பூனையும் கவிதைகளுக்கானவை. மாடு பன்றி ஆகியவற்றை பற்றி எழுதவே கூடாது. மிஞ்சியது ஆடு ஒன்றுதான். பிரச்சனை தராத பிராணி ஆடு. ஆட்டில் 2 வகை, வெள்ளாடு செம்மறி. சுறுசுறுப்பானது வெள்ளாடு. கதையில் ஓட்டம் இருக்க வேண்டும், அதற்கு லாயக்கி வெள்ளாடுதான். ஆகவே வெள்ளாட்டை பற்றி எழுதியிருக்கிறேன். இது முன்னுரையில் சொல்லியிருக்கிற விஷயம். நாவலில் இந்த ஆடு ஒரு இடம் பெயர்ந்து ஒரு வேறொரு ஊருக்கு போகும்போது வழி தவறி ஒரு காட்டுக்குள்ளே போயிடும். அந்த இடத்துல வரக்கூடிய ஒரு சின்ன பற்றி மட்டும் படிக்கிறேன். வனமும் மரங்களும் அவளுக்கு பேராச்சரியமாய் இருந்தன. அங்கே அவள் முயல்களை பார்த்தாள். அவள்னு சொல்கிறது இங்கே அந்த வெள்ளாடு பூனாச்சி. எலிகளை பார்த்தாள், தன்னை கண்டு பயந்தோடும் பாம்புகளை பார்த்தாள். பயமாக இருந்தாலும் ஆர்வமாகவும் இருந்தது. ஏதோ தன் சொந்த வீட்டுக்கு வந்து சேர்ந்தது போல உணர்ந்தாள். சில மரங்களில் போய் தன் உடலை உரசினாள். உடலுக்கு மிகவும் இதமாக இருந்தது. மரங்களுக்கு இடையே மெல்ல இருள் பரவிய போதுதான் ரொம்ப தூரம் வந்துவிட்டோமோ என்று நினைத்தாள். உடனே வேகமாக இறங்கினாள். ஆனால் வந்த தடத்தை தவறவிட்டிருந்தாள். பல பக்கம் ஓடோடி பார்த்தும் சரியான தடத்தை கண்டுபிடிக்க முடியவில்லை. இடைவிடாமல் கத்தி பார்த்தாள். கிழவியின் பதில் குரல் கேட்கும் என நினைத்தாள். ஏதேதோ பறவைகள் கத்தும் சத்தம்தான் கேட்டது. கொஞ்ச நேரத்தில் வாயடங்கினாள். பூனாச்சி தன் புத்திசாலித்தனத்தை அன்றைக்கு அறிந்தாள். இது இந்த நாவலை பொறுத்த வரைக்கும் இதில் இந்த பூனாச்சிங்கிற வெள்ளாடு எதை குறிக்குது அப்படின்னு வாசகர்கள் விமர்சகர்கள் எல்லோரும் கேட்டுக்கிட்டே இருக்கிறாங்க. நான் சொல்லிகிட்டு இருக்கேன், அது வந்து வெள்ளாட்டை மட்டும்தான் குறிக்குது. ஆமாம், ஒரு இலக்கியத்தில் ஒன்று வரும்போது அது இன்னொன்று ஏன் குறிச்சாகணும், இதில் வேறு எதை பற்றியும் நான் எழுதலை, வெள்ளாட்டை பற்றி மட்டும்தான் எழுதியிருக்கிறேன்னு திரும்ப திரும்ப சொல்லிக்கிட்டே இருக்கிறேன். அதை இங்கேயும் சொல்லி முடிச்சுக்கிறேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
மார்னிங், இஸ் நைஸ் டு பி ஹியர் அண்ட் தேங்க்யூ ஃபார் இன்வைட்டிங் மீ to read passages from the shortlisted book Poonachi, the story of a black goat. At first I would like to make some remarks about the experience of translating this book. It's probably one of the quickest translations that I've ever done. It was done, I think, in about 3 months. I normally take about a year. So this was done in a hurry, but I believe it was done well, or tolerably well. The experience of translating a book, it doesn't you know, it is not amenable to a narrative, really, because a translator makes hundreds and thousands of choices. You know, choice of the right word, choice of the right structure for a sentence, choice of tone, and all that. So, it's impossible to narrate, you know, how one made these choices. But we do come across very interesting incidents. So I'll try to speak about three of them very briefly. There's one place where the old man says, in the kuttiki jadagatla kandam irukum, which really means that some danger is indicated in a horoscope, literally. But how to make it literary, or how to make it interesting as part of a fiction. Now, horoscope is actually a document which, in which the relative movement of celestial bodies is indicated, and the effect of that position of those bodies on the individual. So if you can't say horoscope in English because it may not have the same connotation. So I chose to call it destiny. And then the second thing is about kandam. Kandam is actually a kind of danger that is present in your destiny. But kandam also has, it carries a timestamp. Okay, like this danger, you're supposed to encounter this danger at this particular stage in your life. That's how it's done. So merely saying danger is not good enough. So I reduced it to this moment of peril must have been in our destiny. So, well, this is the kind of thing you do when you translate. The second incident came when the old man and his wife cut up the goat, killed goats, and then cut them into small bits and dry them in the sun and cure the pieces with salt so that, you know, they can eat it during a famine. Now, what do you call those pieces? Okay. You can't really call them pieces of meat or pieces of cured meat or salted meat or whatever, because at that point. So I searched high and low for the correct word, and, you know, there was jerky, but jerky doesn't really fit. Finally, I hit upon junk, which was a 18th century English word used for, you know, pieces of meat cured with salt, and it seemed to fit. But how do I know that it's the correct word, or how do I know it will be understood? Then I thought about it, and I realized that junk food, you know, what you call hamburgers or hot dogs and so on, it must have derived, you know, the etymology of junk food actually should have come from junk. And therefore, I was, you know, I felt validated. My choice is validated. So, and junk is a very elegant way to call this thing, because it occurs quite often. And so this is the kind of choice you make. The third choice that I made, and I made a wrong choice, was about the, you know, the metal bit around Punachi's neck in which her number is written. Now, I got stuck on token, because, you know, you go to bank, you get a circular thing with a hole in it and a number. So I knew that it was wrong, but, you know, until the book was published, I wasn't able to really, or until the proofs were fully corrected, I wasn't able to think. But once it had gone to press, it struck me that tag is a better word. Okay, I mean, you know, the number tag, or, you know, your identity. I mean, at least in 20th century, you use tag instead of token. So this is, I mean, you do go wrong. You know, all translation is provisional, so the choices are not sacrosanct. You do the best you can at any particular moment. And so maybe in future editions, I will change it to tag. So this is the quasi-interesting narrative about translation. Okay, now I will read the translation of the passage that Murugan read earlier. It's about Poonachi getting lost in a forest, and her wide-eyed appreciation of what the forest offers her as a as a free being, which he never is throughout the novel. Okay. The forest and the trees seem miraculous to Poonachi. She saw hare, field rats, and snakes that ran away petrified on seeing her. Though afraid, she was also avid. It was a strange feeling, as though she had arrived in a real home. She walked up to a few trees and rubbed her body against a trunk. Only when darkness began to spread slowly among the trees did she wonder if she had walked too far. At once she began to climb down, but she had lost sight of the track she had made on the way up. In spite of running in several directions and looking all over, she could not find the right way back. She tried crying aloud. She thought she would hear the old woman's voice raised in answer to her call. But all she heard was the chatter of unfamiliar birds. After a brief while, she fell silent. Poonachi understood the extent of her intelligence on that day. Darkness fell and all the routes were closed. Left with no other option, she had to spend the night on the hill. Where could she stay? Could she lie down alone, surrounded by the darkness? She was scared. Just then she saw a big pond close by. Water hyacinth covered its whole expanse. She had never before drunk water that tasted so sweet. I missed that. Okay. She wanted to get into the water and swim for a while, but the hyacinth covering the still water made her afraid. She suppressed her wish. Like a hand extending from the edge of the pond, she saw a rock protruding over the water. Wide at the bottom, it became progressively narrow and ended in a sharp point at the top. It looked like the right spot for her. Planting her hooves on the rock, she climbed to the top. No one could get up there. It gave her a sense of security. Thank you.
Anuradha, would you please come?
Thank you for coming, and thank you for listening to all of us one by one. I often tend to fall asleep when people are reading aloud, but the readings today have been wonderful. I'm going to read from my book, which is called All the Lives We Never Lived. And what happens in this book is that a man in his mid to late 60s is trying to make sense of something that happened to him years ago when he was 9 years old. And he woke up one day to find that his mother was not at home. And his mother continued to be not at home. And slowly it sank in that she had left the house. And he grows up without his mother, who is a kind of absent presence in his life. And at this late age, he's trying to make sense of what had happened in his life all those years ago. And while trying to write down his memories, he realizes how unreliable our memories are. And in a sense, when I was writing this, I was thinking of a museum. I had been to a very tiny museum in Cambridge, which was a house that had been turned into a museum. And along one of its windows hung a huge convex glass, a lens on a string. And if you stood near that lens would be just on its own weight, shifting a bit. And as that lens turned, the landscape outside would also be altering and changing. The shapes would keep changing. So the same thing outside kept altering. And this is how it is in this man's mind. So I'll read you a little passage where he's reflecting on whether he'll be able to write this memory of his mother down. In telling the story of any life, and certainly when telling our own, we cannot pretend we are narrating everything just as it happened. Our memories come to us as images, feelings, glimpses, sometimes fleshed out, sometimes in outline. Time solidifies as well as dissolves. We have no precise recollection of how long things took. A few days, weeks, a month. Chunks of time are a blank, while others grow to be momentous in retrospect. I believe this is true of most people. Over the years, when friends contradicted me over details, my uncertain hold over my memories began to make me think I would no longer recognize myself in old photographs. The person in those black and white images was somebody else. Think too hard, and you might think yourself into lunacy. In one of his poems, Rabindranath Tagore says, "I cannot remember my mother. But when in the early autumn morning, the fragrance of the shiuli floats in the air, the scent of the morning prayers in the temple comes to me as the scent of my mother." The poet lost his mother when he was 14. I was only 9 the year my mother left. How can it be then that she is as close to me as my own reflection in the mirror, present in every detail and yet imprisoned in a different element, unreachable? Entire conversations come back to me, incidents, arguments, the way she would line her eyes with kajal, the fresh flowers in her hair, the circle of red kumkum invariably smudged by mid-afternoon. I'm certain I truly remember these things and have not built up impressions from stories and photographs. Yet the older I grow, the less certain I am of certainty. Thank you.
The first line of your book is also so lovely, Anuradha. I said the opening line of your book is so good. I thought you were going to read that. I invite Mr. Arunava Sinha, who has translated Mr. Shishendu Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm sorry, Shishendu Mukhopadhyay couldn't be here, so it's a little bit of an onerous responsibility. The one great thing about much of Bangla literature is that you can plunge straight into the story. You often need no exposition at all. So I'm just going to start reading. The book, this book started as a short story called Roshomoir Shonadana. It then became a novel, Goinar Baksho, then it became a film, and finally now it's in English, The Aunt Who Wouldn't Die. I often wished I could go up to the roof in the afternoons and evenings. The room seemed so dismal, so cavernous, so ghostly that I simply couldn't bear to spend my time in them. The roof would at least offer me a breath of fresh air. I could take a stroll, sing under my breath. Because it was a common roof, some of the other occupants of the house came up too. There were 3 or 4 women of my age. I could have had a chat with them, but I didn't dare go up because of Pishi. Sitting in her room with the door open, facing the staircase, she could make out even if I tiptoed past her. But I was so miserable in my room that day that despite my fear, I made my way to the roof surreptitiously. I was a bundle of worry, apprehension, and anxiety. I did not seem to be experiencing the kind of joy other women felt on getting married. It seemed to me that married life would involve shouldering many burdens which I might not be equal to. I was climbing upstairs quietly. Pishi's room was directly opposite the staircase. The light was switched on. I looked up to find her sitting facing the stairs as usual, fair-skinned, with eyes that seemed to devour everything around her. She used to be a beauty in her youth, but that beauty had never been worshipped. It had consumed no man. Her youth had flowed away in vain. I knew what a litany of regrets her life was. It was no use being angry with fate, with society, with the country, and so her rage was expended on the innocent. Afraid as I was of her, I did not hate her. I stopped a few steps short of her room. The thought of walking past her actually filled me with dread. Peeping in once more, I was a trifle surprised. Pishi was sitting still, the same way as before. Her eyes were open, unblinking. Her mouth had fallen open as well. My heart trembled for some reason. This was not a natural sight. I climbed the last few steps and entered her room. Pishima, oh Pishima. No reply. She kept sitting on her voluminous cane stool, leaning against the wall. I touched her gingerly, holding my fingers beneath her nostrils. My limbs froze. Pishima was probably dead. I was about to run downstairs. Suddenly I heard a voice behind me. Stop! the news can wait. I jumped out of my skin and looked back. Had she not died after all? But she was sitting the same way, her eyes bulging, her mouth open. There was no movement of those lips, but I could clearly hear her speak. Yes, I'm dead. You haven't made a mistake. The wretch is finally gone. I had never been so terrified in my life. I thought I was going to have a heart attack. All of you love the second floor, don't you? You plan to occupy it as soon as I'm dead and share the jewelry and money amongst yourselves. Not a chance. What are you standing there for? Come here, come closer. The order was like a magnet, drawing me slowly towards her. Where did you think you were running off? I couldn't answer. My voice was choked. I could only stare at her. Pishi's dead eyes were boring into me. Take the keys from the end of my sari, go to the north room. You'll find a locked drawer in the large wooden cupboard. Unlock it. There's a wooden box wrapped in an alpaca jacket. Take it and hide it in your room. No one must know. You think I'm bequeathing it to you? My foot. They'll flock around like vultures once they find out I'm dead. That's why I'm getting rid of it. Keep it hidden. My favorite jewelry, I couldn't wear any of it because I was a widow. I'll snap your neck if you even try it on. Nothing must be touched. Go. Thank you.
Pishima then becomes the heroine of the book, becomes the ghost. So thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much, all of you, for being here. As always, it sort of leaves you with a sense of wanting more, but please do get the books and read them. All of them, each one of them is fabulous. And thank you once again. Have a great day. Bye-bye. Thanks all.